building sustainable rural communities, and we have an interesting panel lineup for you. And I'd like to introduce Kate Kennelly, who's the Arts Officer with Kerry County Council, who's going to moderate for us today. Thanks, Kate.
Díomh Galair, agus tá Fáilte roimh gach duine bheith anseo, agus bheith linn an tráthnóna seo. You're all very welcome this evening to this panel discussion on sustaining rural communities. We have an interesting panel for you. I have speakers from the OPW, the National Transport Authority, Transport Infrastructure Ireland, and Fáilte Ireland. So, ladies and gentlemen, if you'd please welcome. From the OPW, we have the chairman, Maurice Buckely. Maurice, if you join us. Thank you. And Maurice will be talking to you shortly. He is involved with estate portfolio management, heritage services, and flood risk management. Next, I'd like you to welcome, please, the Director of Public Transport with the National Transport Authority, Tim Gaston. The National Transport Authority have a number of responsibilities, and Tim will be giving examples of where his agency impacts on sustaining rural communities. So I'm sure you'll find that very interesting. The Director of Marketing with Fáilte Ireland, Niall Treacy, is also with us. And Niall will be talking to us about Fáilte Ireland's key projects at the moment, and again, where they sustain rural communities. And please welcome as well the Head of Roads, Capital Infrastructure with Transport Infrastructure Ireland, Geraldine Fitzpatrick. Now, so we're going to start off with Maurice Buckley from the OPW. So each speaker, ladies and gentlemen, will have approximately 7 minutes. After each speaker has spoken, we'll have some questions among the panel, and then we'll be opening it to the floor. So you'll be very welcome to direct questions to the panel. And please remember, the topic of today is sustaining rural communities. So we're looking forward to your questions as they relate to sustaining rural communities. And thank you for joining us. Thank you, Maurice.
Okay, thank you, Kate. Good afternoon, everybody. So the Office of Public Works, the OPW, is responsible for a number of things. Essentially, the public buildings in Ireland. So we look after all the government buildings in Dublin and around the country, national monuments, heritage houses, and then we have a second stream of activity around flood risk management. So the OPW would be active throughout the country in all the river basins of Ireland in improving the flood protection schemes that we have, which is obviously getting more and more important as the climate changes. It's an organisation of about 2,500 people. And the first thing I would say in terms of sustainable communities is that the OPW is quite a decentralised organisation. We have over 100 sites around the country. And I would say of that 2,500 people, there's only about 500 in the Dublin area. Everybody else is around the country. So it's quite a decentralised organisation. We have a headquarters in Trim in County Meath, and then important centres in Claremorris and Mayo and Kilkenny. So myself, Maurice Buckley, the head of the organisation, I live in Roscommon, a Roscommon town, a rural community itself, and actually before I got involved in the OPW, was running a business there. So I know what it's like to try and keep a business going and a community going and the very strong spirit you can get in our communities, which has to be supported. I would say in terms of the OPW work, there's probably two areas where we really do, I believe, reach out to every corner of Ireland. One is flood risk management. There are rivers everywhere. There are drains, there are arterial drainage schemes, so we do a lot of work to support farming, and we do a lot of work to improve the protection along our rivers to make it possible to have healthier, nicer towns and villages directly along the banks of the river. So that's one area. And the other area, I think, is in the monuments and heritage, because, of course, the castles and the monuments and the lovely houses are all over the country. And to my mind, for a lot of our rural communities, there might be a beautiful old house in the community, a castle in ruins or something. And it's a focal point that we can develop. And we do a lot of work with Fáilte Ireland. Niall will mention it, I'm sure, later, to develop sites all over the countryside. And it's very important. Communities then can develop on the back of that and make it an important attraction to live in the area and for tourists coming in. So that's kind of an outline. Where's Kate got to? Oh, she's here. So certainly happy to take questions later on.
Perfect. Thank you very much, Maurice. And now we'll have Tim Gaston from the National Transport Authority. Thanks, Tim.
Thanks, Kate. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Tim. I was brought up in Northern Ireland in a rural community in the north as well, and spent my school days going to transport by bus, thinking, I wonder what it's like to drive a bus or work in a bus company. And here I am quite a few years later on, involved in public transport. So, I love the job. It's great to be involved in something like public transport. The NTA, the National Transport Authority, not to be confused, and later you'll hear from the TII, who have a different involvement, but that's the roads. We look after public transport. So we're responsible for both the operating and the investment in most of the public transport in the Republic of Ireland. So that means the contracts that Irish Rail, Dublin Bus, Bus Éireann, Go Ahead, who've just launched in Dublin, Transdev, who run the tram system, all are managed by us, as well as Locallink. And I'm going to come back to Locallink in a minute, because that's the service that we support that provides, I think, the most opportunity for sustainability in rural Ireland. If you look around the country, and hopefully we'll have a slide at some point will pop up, you'll see that we've got 17 different Locallink offices dotted around Ireland. And those Locallink offices are manned by local people who run community, used to be the Community Transport Scheme, that then we branded it Locallink. And in fact, we launched it here this time last year. I was here with the wellies. We were under about 2 feet of water, if you remember, on the first day of the ploughing last year. So Locallink has a budget of about 16 million and provides services right across rural Ireland. Two main types of services: demand responsive services, particularly for people with disabilities or mobility issues or local isolation issues, who can in effect order that service and the driver knows to go and pick them up in that locality. And increasingly we're putting in scheduled services, so services running to a schedule the same way Bus Éireann or Irish Rail would do in rural Ireland as well. And we've seen some very significant growth over the last 12 months. In fact, this year we're going to top over 1 million passenger journeys in Locallink, which is really good. In terms of sustainability, we look at it really in two directions. One is we're increasingly trying to serve the whole age range of people who are looking for public transport. It's not just about older people or people who maybe have a difficulty walking or who don't own a car. So one of the things we did this year, for example, we promote a program every year called Kids Go Free. And we provided during the month of July for children right up to the age of 18 to use the rural transport network, the Locallink network, for free. And we had over 15,000 kids took part in that during the month of July. And that's to encourage younger people to move into public transport. Beyond those initiatives, we also do some capital investment. And this year we hope to procure either low emission or zero emission vehicles to pilot in the Locallink network. We haven't yet decided where, but we're hoping to bring in at least 2 vehicles this year. We also have piloted, and much trumpeted as well and talked about in the media, the nighttime services. And those are running mostly Fridays and Saturday nights. We've launched 65 of those this year under pilot conditions, and we'll make an assessment towards the end of the year and hopefully sustain many of those into next year as well. So beyond Locallink, we also invest in Bus Éireann, and we invest in Irish Rail, and we support both of those organisations as they try to provide better connectivity. And really, that's the word we try to use, so that people can get to work, to school, to leisure, to hospital appointments, to doctors. So a lot of what we're trying to do is to improve the network, make the fares more sustainable, more attractive, and make information better as well. Because before you do a journey, you need to know, is the bus going to be there? Is it going to turn up on time? Is it going to get me to my destination on time? So there's lots of other things I could talk about, but really that's the main focus of what we do in the National Transport Authority. Thank you.
Thanks, Tim. That's very informative. And our next speaker is Niall Treacy from Fáilte, Ireland. Thanks, Niall.
That's good. Niall Treacy, my name. It says Fáilte Ireland, we're the tourism development agency. And what I found really interesting about tourism, as the people forget, is just how big tourism is. Look, people also think tourism is a bit of the kind of like, you know, the soft part of the economy. You know, other sectors are more important. But actually, tourism is bigger than education. It's bigger than financial services. It's bigger than construction. You know, tourism employs 235,000 people around the country, and 70% of them are outside Dublin. So it's a huge employer. Huge number of rural communities and people around the country are reliant on tourism, and I think it's one of the great opportunities in order to continue to make kind of like rural Ireland sustainable for the long term, as well as doing it in a sustainable environmental way. You know, tourism last year, we had like 9 million overseas visitors and another 10 million domestically going on holidays. And in Fáilte Ireland, what our focus is very much is on development. So we actually don't build anything. We don't run attractions. We don't have B&Bs or hotels. So what we do is we are purely a service to help communities and businesses all around the country to develop their tourism industry. So we will write large grants for building and creating, say, visitor experiences. We will support companies by developing their people through training. And like last year, we trained 3,500 different companies. And then we also kind of, I suppose, tried to help them develop their business through kind of marketing and doing promotional activity. So for example, one of the things we did was the Wild Atlantic Way, which I think is arriving here for us, especially here in Offaly, so as it's coming in. So we would have developed those regional brands over the last number of years and promoted them to help encourage more and more people to visit Ireland on holiday. But at the heart of what we do in Fáilte Ireland and tourism is what we call the VICE model. Now, VICE stands for visitor, industry, community, and the environment. So what we're trying to do is build a tourism industry that delivers the visitors' needs, is good for local business, but really importantly, it's good for the local community. That is kind of, it's about getting the community part of all our initiatives, and to try and do it in an environmentally sustainable way, in that is, you know, that we're still protecting our natural landscapes and our kind of our natural beauty as we try and grow the industry. So VICE, as I said, is at the centre of our sustainable approach for tourism.
Thanks, Niall. This is what we call a captive audience. You're not going anywhere. Our next speaker now is Geraldine Fitzpatrick, who's with Transport Infrastructure Ireland, which is responsible for the capital infrastructure, formerly known as the NRA, the National Roads Authority, but now Transport Infrastructure Ireland. Thanks, Geraldine.
Hello. Oh, hi. As per my introduction, my name is Geraldine Fitzpatrick from Transport Infrastructure Ireland. Just to explain, Transport Infrastructure Ireland was set up in 2015, and what it was amalgamation of the National Roads Authority, which you may be more familiar with, and the RPA, which is the Rail Procurement Agency. My job in TII is to deal with the national roads and with the capital investment in the national roads and all of the major projects that are currently on the ground. I don't think I need to explain to anybody the importance of the national road networks and how it provides access over the entire country. The National Development Plan, which was published earlier this year, was a very important document for what the work that we do, because in that plan it sets out the major projects that are going to be constructed on the national roads over the next 10 years. It also sets up what is called a number of projects that will be brought through planning and design to work as a pipeline of projects. And this is very important because it means that there's a constant flow of work and a constant building of new national roads in the country. The other important aspect is that we maintain the roads, and the investment that has been provided under the National Development Plan has allowed us to increase the amount of maintenance on the roads and hopefully maintain it to a steady state. I suppose the way we operate, just to explain, is that we deal through the local authorities, and they work as our partners. So what we do is we actually fund the projects and provide the money to the local authorities, and then the local authorities themselves deliver the projects. So we're involved in all of those projects from the time they start off, when you're looking at routes to be developed, until they're actually constructed. And it's all delivered at a local level through the local authority. And we have a number of offices, 11 in total, that are located around the country. So I suppose in conclusion, just on sustainability and rural sustainability, I think there's no argument about the importance of the National Rural Direct Works, how it provides access across the country, how it provides access to services and access for employment. I can get into detail on all of the different projects and that if you want to, and have you any queries during the question time. Thank you.
Thanks, Geraldine. Thank you. So we were talking earlier, and you know, each of the panel members here works with an agency, and that agency delivers on a strategy, and the strategy is devised to have an impact. So I was saying to the panel members that I'd like them to give maybe one or two key examples of real impact of what they do in terms of sustaining rural communities. And we had a conversation about the word sustainability, and you know, we are talking obviously in a number of levels, and you do have sustainability with regard to the environment, but also with regard to making rural areas attractive places for people to live and work. And for those of us who live in rural Ireland, it is very important that supports are given for communities to be vibrant. And communities aren't all about agriculture and tourism, even though they're hugely important in rural Ireland. There are other aspects as well that have come across. And I meant to say, by the way, if anyone wants to send in any comments on social media, it's hashtag GovPlowing18. And some of the comments that have come in have related to health services and access to health services, to education services and access to schools, also to meeting our climate change obligations. So there's a number of issues. I myself work in the area of culture, so with regard to Creative Ireland, which as you know is a national all of government strategy with regard to well-being and creativity, and about helping communities to maximise the creativity at local level towards making local communities more vibrant and attractive places to live and work. And we all have experience of that, festivals, events and so on, that really make places we want to be. But we can't be there if we can't get there, and if they're not economically viable with regard to careers for the upcoming generations, again, communities will perhaps not stay sustainable. I put the question to the panel earlier, and we're going to just talk about it now. Ireland is sometimes described as a two-tier country if you look at Dublin, East Coast versus the rest of rural Ireland. And I've asked the panel to all consider that and to maybe give an example of how their agency is rolling out some key expenditure or key deliverable that has an impact in rural Ireland. So we might start with Geraldine for a change. Thank you.
Sorry, yeah. I suppose one of the big impacts that we're, in the last maybe 20 years, you're all aware of how much the national, the motorway network has developed, and a lot of that work is done. So under the National Development Plan, we're now looking at delivering roads away from the capital on the western coast, connecting towns like Cork and Limerick, which provides access all along the west and tries to counterbalance the impact of the Dublin area. Other kind of things we have been doing recently is we've been involved in what are called low-volume projects, which are around the coast. There's one like in Donegal along the coast. That provides very nice access, tourism access. There's cycleways provided in conjunction with those projects, and it opens up all of the coast for tourism and for access. As well as that, the other things we're doing, obviously by providing access across the entire country, connecting the urban centres outside of the Dublin area, you're opening up all of those areas to employment, to access to services. And the benefits of being able to live in a rural community, and because of an improved network, you're able to get to employment in the urban areas. So I think that is helping towards the sustainability of all of those areas.
Thanks, Geraldine. And actually, Niall, would you like to come in there with regard to the tourism and the road network? And you gave the example of Donegal, and maybe talk a bit about the Wild Atlantic Way or Hidden Heartlands, but with regard to how important the physical road infrastructure is to enabling tourists to visit and stay in areas.
So within them, you know, when we look at tourism, there are two kind of key strategies that we have that we really focus on. One we call seasonality, which is trying to get more tourists and more visitors to come outside of the kind of the busy summer months, so basically extend the season. But the other cornerstone is what we call regionality, which is actually about trying to expand the benefit of tourism to more and more communities around the country. To give you a sense, what it's interesting when we talk about and we quantify, you know, visitors, one thing we actually often use is what we call bed nights, which is basically where do people stay overnight? Because there are a lot of visitors going around, they're maybe traveling on the car or in a bus, and they'll stop off somewhere and they'll have a cup of tea and they'll go to the toilet and they'll wander around a site. And then they get back on and go on to the next destination. But if you can get people to stay overnight, not only do you get the money coming through the cash register in the hotel or the B&B, but you know what? They're also going to go to the pub and have a few drinks. They're going to have their main meal and they'll do a bit of shopping. So it's much better for communities if we can get the most number of, what we say, bed nights into areas rather than just people traveling through. And there's a huge opportunity there. You know, like when you look at visitors, nearly 80% of visitors spend the night in only five counties. So five counties is where vast majority of people actually stay overnight or are on holidays. And that's the Dublin and the Cork and the Kerry, Kilkenny. But actually, if you know, the opportunity there is to give them, we would say, stickiness, give them reasons to go to other parts of the country and stay there. And so what we do is, you know, we were delighted as part of the investment plan, say, for the road network, is that the upgrade of the Dublin Sligo Road. Because at the moment, you know, the classic kind of golden triangle is you land in Dublin, you stay there a couple of days, then you get on the motorway and you might swing by Kilkenny on your way to Cork, and then back up to Kerry, and then back to Dublin, or maybe to Galway and back to Dublin. But it's that kind of triangle in the southern Ireland is kind of like where the majority of visitors go. And by opening up through a major roadway and through the rail infrastructure, the northwest, you know, it's huge potential. Mayo, Sligo, Donegal, you know, even like Letterkenny and Roscommon. And, you know, what we're delighted with is in support of that, you know, I've been very involved with the launch of Ireland's Hidden Heartlands, so a new regional brand. And really what that's trying to do is make people think again about, you know, those counties in the centre are the place you drive through on the way to somewhere else. And what we're trying to do with Ireland's Hidden Heartlands is actually give people a reason to stop and stay. You know, because there's now activities to do, there's now places to stay, and now through transport networks, both road and rail, etc., there's now easy access. And there's a reason why you head up to that part of the country. And our sense of it is actually that's a real opportunity, because with easy access and the right kind of experiences, hotels, accommodation, activities, even nighttime entertainment, etc., on the ground, that will bring visitors to that part of the country. And hence we'll move people from always staying overnight in those five counties to actually spreading that love around more counties around the country. And I think that's going to be a huge opportunity.
Okay. Niall, thank you. And actually, Maurice, if you'd like to come in, we had spoken as well about the links interagency, and I'll come back to you, Tim, about the access, but with regard to the OPW and where, you know, the OPW has a real impact in rural areas with regard to its remit. I'll let you, Maurice.
Yeah. I always think in terms of heritage, as I said, it's a huge opportunity for rural areas because the it's not linked to the towns and the cities. So, for example, there are about 7,000 monuments in Ireland, probably more. And of those 7,000, only about 700 are signposted and are even highlighted on maps. And of that 700, we only have the capacity to open up to the public about 70 of them. So the potential is absolutely huge. I mean, name a county. Roscommon, my county, very good. I mean, Roscommon Castle, it's a beautiful 12th century site. It's barely developed at all. Huge tourism potential if we can find the capacity to develop it further, and this works ahead. Ardkarran on the N4, yep. Hold on a second now, give me another county.
Yeah, that was too easy. He's from Roscommon. Any other county?
Anyone here from Clare? Yeah. Good man. In Kilrush, just off Kilrush, there's a small little island called Scattery Island. Now, at this point in time, it only gets... 2 years ago, it got 500 visitors. Now it's getting close to 5,000. Last year, it won an award, the Eden Award, European Conservation. And it's an absolutely beautiful, historic monastery site on an island, a boat trip out, lovely thing to do with the kids. Mayo? Anyone from Mayo?
He's on a roll now. Yeah.
County Limerick?
Limerick, yeah.
Askeaton Castle. Do you know it? What about what?
Kilmallock. Kilmallock.
Oh, Kilmallock. I have to think about that one.
It's got a Dominican castle from the 12th century.
Yeah.
It's got an abbey from the college church from the 12th century. It's got a gate sponsored by King John of England. King John's castle, we call it only a gateway. It has been totally bypassed simply because of the fantastic roads there at the moment, had bypassing through onto Charles and on the
park. My God. There.
Yeah.
There's been a bit of boardwalks done on keeping the buildings from dilapidated. But when I was going to school, there was a farming Stanley's Castle beside the Valley's Church. And they were here regarding this piece. So, what do the boardwalks do about saying these monuments are ours and we need to have a CPO to get a right of way to these buildings? Because I know it's about to take something like 20 years.
Well, that's a good point you're raising. Sometimes the monuments are in the middle of private property, are in an inaccessible place, and we do try and work with the local authorities and see can we purchase property, or if necessary, we'd try and avoid a CPO in that situation, but to try and improve the access. And as Niall, I'm sure, will tell us immediately, nowadays, there's no point in just having a road up. You've got to have disability access. You've got to have a parking space, not alone for cars, but for buses. We'd like a cup of coffee when we get there. We're used to a much higher standard than we were in the past. We'd like a toilet so we don't have to go behind the wall. So there's actually quite a project in developing any of those sites. And it's a case of local community. I mean, if a local community lobbies for this, you'll get Fáilte Ireland coming behind it, you'll get the OPW coming behind it. You know, maybe we can't afford to have a full-time guides there, but there are examples where local communities on a volunteer basis get things going. I'll have to talk to JP McManus maybe about Kilmallock, maybe there's something can be done.
Well, I think you've put it on the map, which is very important for today. And as Maurice was saying, local community lobbying and show the interest, show the commitment, and that makes it so much easier for the agencies to engage at local level and make it happen. Might come back to you now, Tim, because... Oh, sorry, Niall, did you want to hop in?
Well, actually, just to, that local community is really at the heart of this. You know, and it's funny when you look at some of the, you know, one of the things when the gathering happened there a number of years ago, one of the reasons when you look back at why that worked was actually it was community driven. Actually, it wasn't coming down from Dublin or on high to say, now you all have to do this. It was actually say, listen, you've got communities, you've got the parishes and the counties and the regions. You know the people who used to live there, you've got the contacts, you know why they should come back for a visit. You know what the festival is or what the activity is. And so actually getting the community involved and harnessing the community on the ground, actually that was the great success. And you know, like when I look at say the Wild Atlantic Way, Wild Atlantic Way is only about 4 years old. Like you kind of feel it's been there, it's been there forever, but it has been as a named about 4 years. And when the great reason, I think the reason why that worked so well and so quickly was because from the very start, it was launched with the idea of getting the communities behind it and see would they support it. And there was huge support for it. And I think that's why the Wild Atlantic Way is considered to be such a great success. Not because of anything that we did in Fáilte Ireland. I'd love to say it was all us. It wasn't. It was actually all the communities right down from Millicent to Mallon, you know, all working on how they could bring it to life and deliver some fantastic experiences for people who want to go along that route. So one of the things we're big fans of is, and we have a it's called, we call them VEDPs, but that's, is this idea of, we try to bring, help bring communities together, because it's not always easy for a community to come together and to get the right people around the table. So what we do is we'll set those up. And you've got people like local authorities, the OPW, you know, we'll have Queel Chatters, as well as the local tourist groups, local community groups, chambers, to say, right, here's an area in this county. We think it's got an awful lot of opportunity. What could it be? And as I said, it isn't just about opening up a kind of a big heritage site and making it safe and as a tourist site, but it's also about, well, how are they going to get there? You know, what road networks? You know, do you have parking? Do you have toilets? Do you have places they could stay and stay overnight? Because the magic dust is get them to stay overnight. That's where the real richness comes from. And so we work with communities all along, not just the West Coast, but through Ireland's ancient East as well, to try and get those communities to work together to figure out the right answer. And then we can support them with grants and training. But really it is about getting the communities, because they know the area so much better than anybody else does, and being able to harness it and work together to deliver great success.
Thanks, Niall. And I'm going to go back to Tim, because what comes up the whole time is access and getting there. So Geraldine has already spoken about the NRA, which is now TII, and the capsule infrastructure. But you might talk more about public transport and sustaining rural communities and what you're working on.
Thank you, yes. Public transport in rural communities can be a challenge, because often the roads can be quite small, quite narrow. There may not be able to get a decent full-length 53-seater coach down some of the roads that people are living on. So in fact, what we do in the Local Link program, almost all of the vehicles that are, and most of them are secured through local businesses actually, put out to tender, or local businesses win those, which is sustainability in itself actually brings employment. Most of those are minibuses, and we're moving to either low flow or minibuses with accessible features that allow wheelchair access or for other people with walking disabilities to get onto them. And that network of minibuses can be booked, as I was saying earlier, on the demand responsive model. So contact your local link office, and they're all available, locallink.ie, or they all advertise quite widely. We're running an advertising campaign at the minute with Marty Morrissey, if anybody's heard of him, running a TV campaign promoting Local Link. And the concept there is that you contact your local link and say, I would like to do this journey, that if your vehicle doesn't run, I will not be able to do that journey. And that might be a journey to go to school, or to work, or to a men's club, or to some other community gathering. And the local link office will then look at that and see if there's other demand in that area that they can turn into a service, which might be demand responsive. We also provide one-off grants, small grants, maybe 10,000, 5,000, 20,000 euros for specific events, might even be a community festival or a school trip or something like that. And again, the sense of it is this would not be provided if we didn't fund that particular event. And then another initiative that we brought in just in the last couple of years, and I touched on this earlier as well, is more around scheduled services. So if you're a tourist and you want to visit Wild Atlantic Way or some other tourist venue, or if you're living in rural Ireland and you want to get to, on a regular basis, to work or to school or to some other event, you need to work to a schedule. Demand responsive isn't really going to work for you. And Bus Éireann provide a very good network of services, but where do they stop and where do these minibus type services take over? And what we're trying to do is to bridge that gap by providing scheduled services. In other words, you know it says on the timetable it's going to be there at 8 o'clock, so it's there at 8 o'clock. You know it's going to get to town before 9 o'clock, so you can connect to a train or to a bus, air and vehicle or to college, whatever. And we're putting out a lot of those scheduled. We've launched 7 or 8 of those this year already, and we're seeing a very significant uptake on that. And again, that's bringing work into those local areas, because those are all of the small contracts all being won by local businesses. Now, at this stage, it's small numbers, but we are seeking more funding, and government is very supportive of providing funding for that sort of service. And we're seeing very significant growth in the sort of scheduled services that we're able to offer. And one particular feature of those, just touch on it for a second, is town services. Take a town like Cavan. Last year, we launched new services running from the rural community around Cavan into Cavan. And they were timed to meet with the Bus Éireann services in Cavan town to take people down onto the next stage for the longer journey. We have a long way to go in this stuff. There's a lot of hard work to be done. But we have, as I said earlier, we have 17 offices dotted around the country. If you're interested in promoting either a one-off or a particular tourist service or a regular service, contact those offices, badger them to look at what additional services can be put in. They make applications to us, and then we then enable that to happen.
Okay, thank you. We're going to open it to the floor in just one moment. I just have one more question that I'd like the panel to go through. I was asking what percentage of the panel's overall budget is being spent in rural Ireland, because being a Kerry woman, I'm very interested in that. And for those of you that know the answer to that, if you know, you know, in terms of your overall budget, and then what percentage is being spent in rural Ireland, and like that, there might be an example that you'd like to talk about, and then we'll maybe open it to the floor. So we might start with you this time, Maurice.
Yeah, it's a good question, and I probably can't give you an exact answer. And what do we define as rural Ireland? Is it just outside Dublin, or are we also saying outside Cork and Galway and everywhere else? But certainly in the OPW, we look after the main national buildings, the Phoenix Park and Farmley House and so on. So there is a lot in Dublin on the building side. But once you start talking about heritage and monuments, I would say 3/4 of the activity is outside of Dublin. And on the flood relief side, it's probably even more, because that is evenly spread all over the country. Obviously, it follows the major river basins, the Shannon Basin and all the other rivers. So apart from the Liffey, that's all out of the capital. So there is a lot there.
Okay, thank you. And Tim, I was trying to get Tim to invest in some light rail networks in Kerry, and he was having none of it. But Tim, you might want to...
Well, light rail in Kerry, yes, that's a good question. We'll come back to that later, Kate. There's two main areas of funding. One is capital funding, and capital funding is completely skewed by large projects. Large projects are where you've got high densities of people, which is the East Coast. So Metrolink, for example, over the next 10 years will absorb a very significant chunk of our capital funding. However, in terms of operational funding, we fund Bus Éireann almost to the tune of the same value of what we fund Dublin Bus. Dublin obviously is in the bus is just in the Dublin area. Bus Éireann is national. Irish Rail, likewise, is spread largely by route kilometre. So it would be a disproportionate amount of Irish Rail's capital investment will be, and in the maintenance side in particular, will be away from Dublin. Having said that, when you look at the spend per journey, the subsidy away from Dublin is much higher, but that's simply because of the maths, because you've much smaller numbers travelling. So the subsidy per journey is much higher outside of Dublin, but then it would be because you've got so many more passengers, if that makes sense.
Okay.
Yeah?
Thank you. Niall?
We're very lucky. We do have large budgets because we're there to, as I said, we're the Tourism Development Authority. So we're there to support development. So you need funds for that. And interesting. So actually, by the nature of it, actually the vast majority of our investment actually goes outside Dublin, because really what we do is we invest in programs that actually wouldn't get off the ground unless somebody steps in to help them. But once they're up and running, then they kind of actually can survive very nicely by themselves. So, for example, we're looking at doing a big investment into Strokestown House in Roscommon, actually. With this coming, the National Famine Museum. Now, there's a number of millions going to go in there in order to bring it up to kind of like to the standard you want. But once it's up and running, then it becomes very sustainable and actually becomes, you know, and it's self-sustainable. So we would have, like last year alone, we invested like 26 million in capital projects around the country, from visitor centres to development of things like lighthouse destinations, etc. So I would say, you know, and as well as another 20 million in training programmes and marketing and various current activity. And I would say nearly 90% of all that funding would go outside Dublin into rural areas, because actually that's where the great opportunity is for growth of tourism. Because I said, one of our big things is about regionality and getting people into new areas. And Dublin's a capital city. It'll always attract tourists purely because it's a cheap Ryanair flight to Dublin. No, really our trick is how do you get them out of Dublin and into areas that they wouldn't normally travel to. And investing in those areas, creating fantastic experiences, create really holiday destinations with more than just attractions and with hotels, etc. And a nighttime economy is the trick of getting people into these other areas to spread the benefit of tourism into a wider area.
Okay, thank you. And Geraldine, would you like to answer that?
I suppose from the National Road point of view, a lot of the major projects around the Dublin area are in place. So the bulk of our money is actually going to projects outside of the Dublin area. On the pavement maintenance of the roads as they are, the money is funded based on need, and the need is greater in the regions, obviously, as the pavements break down. And so I'd say about 90% of our overall funding is all outside the Dublin area.
Okay, thank you very much. And just before I hand over to the floor, I had one other question. What would you say, and for those of you who joined us a bit late, we have representatives from Transport Infrastructure Ireland, Fáilte Ireland, the National Transport Authority and the Office of Public Works. Just one other question, what would you say is your biggest challenge at the moment? So we might send that to Tim, thank you, to start.
I'm glad I brought my bellies, but my greatest challenge in public transport, that's a good question actually. I think it's convincing people to trust us, and that maybe sounds a bit odd, but what we're trying to do is provide a viable alternative to the car. Now, if you live in rural Ireland and there isn't a bus nearby, you're kind of caught out. So we're actually doing some in-depth studies at the minute in a couple of specific counties, and the question we're asking ourselves is, can you live here without access to a car? And the answer is coming back for many communities, actually, it's very difficult. So one of the things we're trying to do is say, right, we can provide a layer of public transport, but people will only use it if they trust us. So we're looking at providing better information in advance of traveling. What is the timetable? Can I get access to that timetable? What's the reliability of that service? If I go and stand at that bus stop, will it turn up? If it doesn't turn up, will there be another one in 30 minutes? And if you're in a city or Cork or Galway or Dublin or one of the larger cities, you probably get buses every 10 or 15 minutes around the main road network. But it's rather different if your service is every 2 hours. So I suppose that's our biggest challenge, is to put in the quality of service that in turn earns the trust of people to use it. Because what we do find is when you put in a quality product, people use it. And we've very good examples of putting in services, improving the reliability, improving the punctuality, and guess what? Passenger numbers go through the roof. So I suppose that's our biggest challenge. It's around quality and confidence.
Okay, and you're on the case.
Well, we're doing our best to try and up the game, yeah. We're turning the screw on the contracts with all our operators, the big ones, the small ones. We're trying to certainly drive that reliability and that punctuality thing, as well as all of the other features. The price is important. The cleanliness of the vehicle, the branding, the information behind it. But at the end of the day, you need to know it's going to turn up, and you need to know when it's going to turn up. And that's our absolute top focus, punctuality, reliability. As I say, capture one word, I think it's around confidence of the product.
Perfect. Thank you. And Maurice, would you like to come next?
I suppose our biggest challenge at the moment, I would say one of them anyway, is we have, thankfully, the government has allocated a lot of money to flood relief works at the moment, €1 billion over 10 years. But it's actually quite hard to develop schemes that the communities involved are fully happy with. It takes a long time. I mean, you'll please 80% of the people, but it's very hard to get 100% of the people behind whatever idea is there, because it might be changing the course of a river, it might be putting a wall, putting something that wasn't there before, and the community is going to have to live with this for the next 100 years. So we find it quite difficult. I mean, Cork City is a very good example when, you know, it is severe flooding in recent years several times, and something is badly needed. But there are genuine concerns amongst at least a small group of people, and you have to listen, you have to respond. And so it's very hard. Then you've got planning, then you've got environmental concerns, and they're all very important, and not diminishing any of them. But to, you know, worried on the one hand, I mean, we had a bit of climate change a few minutes ago, nearly knocking the roof of the tent. You would have to worry that, can we get everything in place fast enough to respond? If we had another difficult winter this year, I hope not, like we had in 14-15, you know, are we equipped for it? We are in some areas, but there's a lot of areas where we wouldn't be.
Okay, thank you. And that's very interesting. Niall, would you like to go next?
Yeah, I think the in some ways, you know, I think one of the great challenges we have to some degree in tourism is our success. You know, we have, you know, as I mentioned earlier on, we have this thing called the VICE model. So when I look at visitors, the V, you know, we survey visitors on their, after their holiday as they're leaving through the ports and airports. The satisfaction levels are through the roof. We're talking about 98, 99% of people who visit Ireland are going home going, that was a fantastic trip. So visitors are loving coming to Ireland. You know, the industry are hugely supportive in the, you know, as guys there, you know, they've really been up in their game. They're really trying to take to provide the best services, and they really, you know, even like from 10 years ago, the experienced visitors are getting on the ground because the way the industry is focused is so much better. And even the communities, you know, like, you know, the communities all around the country, and we do a lot of research with communities, they recognize the value of tourism, not just financial value, but the fact that it gives their sons and daughters an opportunity to have a career based back in their home county, in their own area, and the importance that they have, not that they have to stay low, they have to stay home, but they can if they want to, because tourism gives them those kind of opportunities. And also actually, the communities are interesting, they actually love having visitors around, showing off the hidden gems of the various counties. And then we also do a lot of work on the environment, as regards just tracking, you know, the environmental impact of things like the Wild Atlantic Way, to make sure that we're also protecting the natural landscape. But I think the greatest challenge is that, you know, all tourism is going to do is grow. All global trends say tourism will grow. Now you'll have up years and down years, but the long-term trend for tourism is growth. So actually our greatest challenge is investing for that growth. Because we are doing really well at the moment with communities and visitors and the industry and everybody. But to maintain that, you have to invest behind it. You have to kind of invest more into attractions to give people more options, give people better experiences, to upgrade. You know, like we're doing a lot of work with OPW in the Blasket Islands, and the, you know, there's the visitor centre there in the Blasket is, like that was built, what, 1990s? So it's dated, it's from a different era. But actually just to upgrade that will unlock not just that, but all that whole island network to more visitors and to give them even a better experience. So I think our great challenge is actually not sitting back and going around saying, golly, isn't tourism great? We can ignore that now for a while. But actually it's getting reminding people that actually you've got to invest for growth in order to be able to be ready for when that growth comes in and take full advantage of it.
Thanks, Niall. And that brings us nicely on to Geraldine, because, again, it's the movement of people is essential to tourism. So Transport Infrastructure Ireland, what's your greatest challenge, Geraldine?
I suppose from our point of view, the biggest challenge is just managing and expectations of people. There's a lot of projects identified, and we're limited in the amount of money that we have to bring all of those projects forward. And the other aspect of that is it takes a long time to develop a road project. A big project can take 5 to 6 years to get through planning approval. And I think the expectation is there that once a project is identified, it can be delivered in a number of years. But it's taken up to 10 years to get an actual project on the ground and in place. And people think they're being delivered slowly, but it's actually the length of time and the whole process that's involved in getting these projects in place. So they're probably our biggest challenge, is the expectations that they're out there. There's so much work to be done, and it's trying to keep up with the demand and deliver all of the projects that we'd like to deliver and manage our funding.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Now we'll open to the floor, and don't be shy. Yeah, we have. Would you give your name when you take the microphone, please? And we'll take your question. Thank you.
Tony Bambrick from Roscommon, and I have been involved for the last 26 years with the restoration of graveyards in Roscommon, four of them. One of the things that, you know, Maurice mentioned it about volunteerism. We had a fantastic scheme, which was the Summer Student Job Scheme in 1995. We had six students on that scheme, and those six students were paid €600 for the duration of the scheme and the summer job scheme. And they actually took down and catalogued every single headstone in the graveyard, put it on a map. It was done at, well, the whole cost of the thing was £2,000, and it was raised locally. But that scheme is gone completely. It doesn't exist since 1996. And everybody asks us, how did you get this done? How much do you pay? Today, to do the same job by a private company is £14,000. The same job with a private company hiring them in. So the state paid €600 for six workers for the duration of the summer when they were in school. Why is that? My question is, why is that scheme abandoned? And can you ensure that that goes back up? Because when Maurice mentioned about a volunteer coming, we have a man who we pay every week to cut the grass, and he said, I'm stopped every time with people coming in. Is there no tour guide here? Exactly what you said. He said, will you for God's sake put in a tour guide? Because people are coming in, not local to the area, they're from Dublin, it's on the N4, to come across, to see all the monuments, and there's nobody there to tell them. Now, if you had a trained person employed under the summer job scheme, they would be able to do that work, train them up locally, cost effective. Gone since 1996, you know. So take 3,600 in 1996, today 14,000. What makes sense, the economics? 3,600. Well, my question is, when is it coming back?
Well, now that's a very good question, and I unfortunately can't answer it, and I'm not sure any of you, Maurice, might like to.
Well, I can't, and I'm not familiar with that particular scheme, but I think in general, though, one of the things that the Department of Community and Local Affairs wants to do is develop methodologies like that. We used to have a lot with LEADER, community employment, different things that would help out, just kickstart things. And maybe some of those have passed their sell-by date, and we are now in an era we're approaching full employment, so we have to be careful not to be subsidising jobs where there might be jobs available. We have to watch all those things. But I think the trick is to find new ways to get the equivalent subsidy, the equivalent support out there to community groups like your own. So just make it viable to do things. You can't do everything for free. You have to be able to support it in some ways.
Yes, and certainly we'll pass back feedback from today anyway. We were asked to be here by the Department of An Taoiseach, so we will pass feedback. Yeah, absolutely, we'll do. Enjoy. Yes. Any other question? What's your name, please?
Yeah. Hello. Tom Trainer from Monaghan.
Tom.
And there's great enthusiasm up in Monaghan that maybe someday we'll get our Ulster Canal opened again. Be a wonderful cross-border project there, right up to from Loch Ney. It would, join the west of Ireland right up there. And I'm wondering, you know, is there any interest or funding there to drive that project from Fáilte, Ireland?
I'm not sure. What I can say is that the we work very closely with Tourism Northern Ireland, so our agency up north, and particularly looking at like where opportunities there are for kind of cross border opportunities. You know, like I mentioned briefly there earlier on, Ireland's hidden heartlands. Now, really, if you look at it as a 32 county, you know, Fermanagh should be part of that as well, because it's part of that same kind of like water network. And, you know, and they've got a similar type of terrain around it for fishing, for cycling, for walking, as does the, you know, as does Roscommon and Longford, etc., down Westmeath. So we are looking at, and we have over the years been doing more and more with bodies across the north. Interestingly, there is at the moment, because of the lack of government in Stormont, it's hard to kind of get things agreed, you know, but we are working very closely to try to, you know, that whole area of Monaghan and the border counties to try and bring more people up there. We did a program actually with Tourism Ireland there last year, where we did a lot of, we actually created itineraries for tour companies from particularly from the UK, which brand new itineraries that brought them up and down the border counties across each side of the border. And actually they were hugely successful because tour operators love them because they're not trying to follow every other tour operator, you know, down towards the Kerries and the Munster area. And actually, the people who go on those holidays, they want to go somewhere that's a bit more rural, a bit more kind of like, you know, where you've kind of got the natural beauty is still there and they're meeting the locals and they're just doing it. It's like a different pace of a holiday. So, to be honest, I would agree with you. I think we are very focused on trying to unlock more around the border counties and more cross border working, because we do believe actually there's a huge opportunity there to bring more people who want that kind of holiday up into that area.
Well, now, Tony, you're talking to the right man because he's the director of marketing. So, you know, you're on the radar. It's very important. And Maurice, did you want to, in terms of inland waterways, did you want to come in there or...?
Well, I mean, inland waterways, I think, would be on the case in developing Waterways Ireland. There's also the regional fund or the new fund launch, Rural Initiatives Fund, is it? I can't think of the right name, but there is, as part of the Project Ireland 2040, there is a large fund, it's €1 billion, I think, for projects in rural areas, towns smaller than 10,000 people, And it could just be the kickstart that you need if you get the County Council and maybe some other groups together.
The Regional Development Fund, is what you're saying? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much for that. We have another question here.
Sorry, my name is Barbara Nikengsa. I'm actually from the Department of Rural and Community Development. And just coming in on some of the points that were made earlier, that our tent is, if you take turn right and it's immediately on your left, Department of Rural and Community Development, our remit is to support the type of community and volunteer projects that the panel has been talking about. And there are a number of schemes. We have a stand there from Volunteer Ireland talking about volunteers, how to support volunteers. The community employment scheme is still available. There is a scheme called the SICAP, the Social Inclusion and Community Activation Programme, where you can get local support. So if you go down to the tent, there's lots of stands where people will fill you in on supports that are available for local communities who want to take action. And in relation to the fund as well, the Rural Regeneration and Development Fund is the 1 billion euro fund that Minister Michael Ring has responsibility for, and he will actually be here tomorrow at 11:30 talking about that. So any of you who are around tomorrow as well.
Thank you very much for that. Have we any other questions from the floor? We have. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Tom McTeague from Galway. Just about border rural communities, is there any strategy or thinking around Brexit in relation to sustainable border rural communities for any of the agencies? Because it's certainly very topical at the minute, as we know, on Brexit. And the second question is, the Department of Agriculture have a very extensive rural development program, and in that they provide sustainable agriculture in terms of provision of public good in relation to animal health, welfare, protection of environment. Does any of the agencies see cultural heritage or rural heritage being factored into that or liaised with the Department of Agriculture to promote cultural heritage, as has been outlined by the speaker from Limerick previously? Thank you.
Thank you. Just before the panel answer, just to let the audience know, there is a Brexit discussion panel at 11:30 here tomorrow, and it's Ireland's agricultural sector and the economy, and it's all talking about Brexit, and it's a ministerial panel, so definitely come again for that. But if any of the panel would like to address those questions, Maurice.
I'm not qualified to really respond on the Brexit issue, except obviously, as you know, The government is working very hard to make sure that there is no land border across Ireland, and that communities can continue to flourish and develop as they have been in the past. And all the initiatives that are part of the Good Friday Agreement will hopefully be able to continue and help those communities. In terms of the links to agriculture and heritage, it's an interesting one, and it's one to think about more, I must say. There can be a heritage site that can be part of a local community. There can be maybe a greenway in the same area. So you can develop communities, but the actual link to agriculture itself, I'm not sure. But if you had some examples, certainly we could...
We say, for instance, we have traditional meadows in promotion of traditional meadows, traditional pastures in the rural development program. Yeah. Also, the promotion of farming heritage in the Broadstone. We have, for instance, the Derry Glad Museum in South Roscommon. We have the Turley Rural Museum in Castlebar. And it's working around rural tradition, I'm thinking more of, you know, as to bring in the farmers as part of that.
Okay, certainly a very good idea. And one comment I would make is, as you mentioned, the things like biodiversity and the different ways of growing crops and protecting the various different elements in the insects, the birds, the animals, in the environment. That is, we notice in our parklands and in our houses,
people are more and more interested in the environment, in the lawns and the hedgerows, in all of that. And the numbers visiting those areas and asking questions about those areas is skyrocketing. So, I mean, it would suggest that there is something there.
Yeah, actually, George, it's a really interesting question. Actually, I'm going to try and answer, connect the two, your two questions together, because you know, since 2016 and the Brexit vote happened, we've put in tourism, we've had this program called Get Brexit Ready. And basically what it is, it's a training program for tourism business to basically get ready for Brexit. And really at the cornerstone of that is, you know, is actually, you know, you're likely to lose quite a bit of your Northern Ireland and UK visitors because of currency and potential border issues. So our big focus was we need to diversify who comes and visits your attraction or your hotel, etc. So to give you a sense of it, in 2012, like 30% of all visitors to Ireland were from GB. In 2017, it was only 20%. So like a huge drop off from 30% down to 20% in only 5 years. And that's because actually we've been Tourism Ireland have been promoting Ireland much more in North America and also in China. But what's really interesting about, you know, when you talk to American tourists, and particularly Chinese tourists, they love Irish farming. Because actually you've got to remember, you know, like, you know, we go to Britain an awful lot, so we're used to Ireland and having farms on our doorstep, you know. And but actually if you're from the States, if you're from China, you do not see a cow. When would you see an animal? You see, you know, and actually to be able to actually visit a farm and to actually even to drive through farmland is a huge buzz for them. So actually because of the continued growth from North America and now with China, I think one of the really interesting opportunities for farmers as regards to as an alternative source of income is actually farm tourism. And you know, farm tourism isn't about, well, opening up the gates of your farm and anybody can walk in whenever they want. You know, often it's very managed. You know, there's a group will come at 12 o'clock. You know, they'll want a bit of a tour. You'll give them a bit of lunch, maybe some, you know, from based on your produce or for the animals that are on the land, and they're gone by two. And you can get really good money because they're loving just the genuine, authentic farm experience that goes back maybe generations, because they just don't have that. That just doesn't, you know, and even in places like Germany, they don't have that. Because again, these are very urbanized countries. And one of the reasons they come to Ireland is because of the natural beauty and the people. And that comes together in its perfect form, really, in farms. So it's something that, I know, it's a great one in Mayo, it's a great one in Wicklow already doing this. But I think actually that idea of the farming culture and bringing that to life is something that I know we're very keen in Fáilte Ireland to help encourage and develop, and that we talk to the IFA about it, etc.
Thank you very much. And there is always strong demand. I worked in tourism years and years ago, and the farmhouses were always booked out very quickly in the area. And like that, we have Muckra's traditional farms down in Killarney, and it's very popular. People can go in to watch the plough horse. They can watch the cow being milked. They can watch butter being made. Very, very popular with buses and with independent travellers. So one more question there. Thank you.
Two tour groups here today, actually, Asian visitors being led around by a guide. And I thought, isn't this a fantastic thing that only in Ireland could you see so many people enjoying the authentic rural life? And it's really good to see. You're right.
Thank you. Have we any more? We have one gentleman over here. Thank you.
Hello, how are you? My name is Martin Barlow. I live here near Tullamore. For the last two quarters of an hour now, I have been listening to what I would almost consider a group of politicians from the same party singing from the same hymn sheet. Anyway, I want to just direct this towards Mr. Gaston and Niall Treacy in particular, that back last April, I took public transport here in North Erin from Tullamore to Sligo. Went on Saturday, came back on Monday. I decided I'd leave the car at home and use public transport instead. Anyway, the cost was €88 return, and I walked between Houston Station and Connolly Station, both Saturday and Monday, respectively. Now, I mean, I don't know how Mr. Gaston can talk or even try to praise public transport in this country. It's really an absolute disgrace. And I will take up a point with Mr. Treacy as well about It's very easy to be incredibly patronising about how tourists respond to their visits in Ireland. They will respond positively in relation to the way they're treated and the hospitality and people being friendly and helpful. They will not respond positively when it comes to the cost. I mean, myself, a friend of mine and his three sons, 3 weeks ago, we went to Germany. When we stayed in farmhouse accommodation in the Black Forest Mountains near Schonau, we were registered as guests and we were given cards, which gave us free transport in Baden-Württemberg in that state while we were there. We did not have to pay for public transport at all, and it was there available to us at all times. The last bus would get us back to the accommodation at midnight. They ran every half an hour up until 8 o'clock, and then every hour after that. I mean, I think if you people spent more time in countries like Switzerland and Germany, and not all the time, you know, echoing the government's ideology. The same shambles exist in housing. The same shambles exist when it comes to road transport. And it might be worth making a point here to that woman representing the roads capital. A small lane in Killorn, Mohia Lane, was gone into such bad repair, it was difficult to use it for anything else other than to take a tractor and trailer up and down. Petitions were made to Offaly County Council, so eventually they agreed to resurface the lane with the cheapest way possible, tars and chipping, I mean, which is not used anywhere in Europe. And Conor Faulkner from the AA has repeatedly said that this is a dangerous practice, putting loose chippings out on public roads where the windscreens of cars are likely to be broken. Now, I mean, the only way Offaly County Council would do it was that each household, and there are 30 on that particular lane, stumped up €250 each to get the work done. Now, they refused to do it otherwise. And basically, there was a petition and meetings, and everybody came around, and we basically had to contribute €250 just to get the very basic work done. Now, I mean, where are we going? Or what's ever going to be done about this? I mean, when is government going to take responsibility and stop shifting it onto somebody else? We pay the household charge. We pay household charge. We pay road tax. If you drive out and your car is on tax, the guards will confiscate the car and impound it. And then you have to pay, you know, a daily fine for the fact that the car is impounded on state property. So, I mean, I think we need to start looking at the bigger circle and start dealing with the inadequacies rather than, you know, pompously praising ourselves continually. Thank you.
Thank you, Martin. Now, I just don't think the panel were being pompous. They were trying to very much communicate what their areas of responsibility are and what's working. I did ask them what their impact was in rural areas. You've raised very valid points, and if any of the panel want to come in. Tim?
Personally, actually, I largely agree with most of what you're saying about public transport. There's no doubt our public transport in this island doesn't match what you find when you go to the continent. However, I think you're confusing us with the politicians. We don't make the decisions on how the funding is, how much funding is put into our services. Our job is to take that funding and use it as best we can. We have seen an increase in funding since the recession, since the depth of the recession, but there is no doubt if you travel in Switzerland or in France or across most of the European countries, yes, the investment in public transport and the support for the day-to-day services is at a much higher level than it is in this country. That's just a fact. That's undeniable. What we can say, though, is where we're trying to be effective. And I was talking earlier about gaining the confidence. Our job is to try and put the money that we do get, and we're very welcome to get funding. We're obviously grateful to government, of course, when they fund us. But it's to use that as effectively as possible. So I'm very happy to chat with you afterwards with others with ideas as to how we can be more effective at providing the sort of service that you're talking about at the sort of price that people can afford it.
Okay, thank you. And Niall?
Yeah, just pick up particularly on the pricing and the value for money. And Joe, you're absolutely right. Like, you know, what visitors love about Ireland is, as you say, it's the welcome, it's the chat, it's the hospitality they get. The fact is, we're not a cheap place to go on holiday to. We're not a cheap destination, you know, and I don't think we ever will be. But I think what we have to be, and this is what we're trying to encourage, particularly the industry, the accommodation providers and the attractions and the activities, is it's all about value for money. It's not about being the lowest price, but it's making sure that what you give the visitor is worth the money you're going to charge them. You know, and you know, I know where we do a lot of tracking, and you know, the bits that concern me at the moment are things like the price of accommodation, the price of eating out, and the price of drink. Those three comes up a lot as being the three kind of areas where visitors say that, you know, they see us as taking high price in those areas. Now, we can't control the prices. That's individual B&Bs, hotels. What we try to do is explain to the importance and make sure they give value for money in what they do. Your point about travel for visitors and connecting the dots and again value. You know, I know one of the things we do work on is try to make it easier for people. Like, it's hard, like if you're a visitor arriving into, say, Dublin or into one of the cities, it's often hard to figure out how to get around. Nevertheless, you know, what public transport is. So we do a lot of work on trying to work with local authorities to improve the signage and the orientation to make it easier. No, giving people good value for money and getting the prices right is, you know, it's an ongoing challenge, you know, and it's something that we're constantly working with the industry to try and encourage them to deliver a great experience.
Thank you. And actually, Martin, just for your information again, and I meant to announce this at the start, there is a ministerial panel discussing sustainable rural communities on Thursday at 11:30 here. So the ministers with responsibility for these areas will be present. Might be no harm for you to, if you're around, I don't know if you are on Thursday. Yes. I think, Martin, just with regard to what we're here to discuss today, that's a bit beyond it, you know. Yeah. I know, and thank you. Yeah. Well, that's your opinion. Thank you. Yes. Are there any more questions from the floor, please, on sustaining rural communities, or are we done? We're done. Okay.
Can I throw in one? Yes, you can indeed.
Thank you.
Okay. If I could throw in one from left field, just before we finish. Niall mentioned a couple of times the centenary celebrations that we've had from 1916 a couple of years ago and how successful they were in boosting tourism and everything else. One thing about 1916, though, it was very much Dublin concentrated, as was the centenary commemorations. What the country would like to do is commemorate now, over the next number of years, all of the following events that happened, 1920, 21, 22... 23, the major events in our history, that 50 years ago, when the state was 50 years old, we just couldn't do because they were still too sensitive, too difficult for families, for communities, and they might still be today. But those events, and the instances there on the War of Independence, Civil War, and so on, took place all over the country. And if any of you in local communities have ideas, is there something that happened in your community that you think would make a good event, a good commemoration, might even heal wounds or whatever. Maybe Tim and I, our families 100 years ago, were at loggerheads with pitchforks across a turnstile. And you know, the 1916 commemoration was a real healing, and it was very, very valuable like that. But as I say, there's opportunities around the country. There's a lot of OPW sites that might form part of that. And if you have any ideas, do write into us and we'll give them good consideration.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, thank you for being here today. And I'd like to thank our panellists for their time. Thank you. With regard to all I'd like to say in terms of closing remarks, the panellists all have very interesting work areas and they're responsible for budgets, strategies. you know, make yourself familiar. I certainly wasn't aware of the number of local links, the transports available. I wasn't aware of the support from the NTA for events in terms of transport. So, you know, there are opportunities, and I've seen from this audience you're very committed. There's a lot of energy in the community. So please contact the agencies. That's what we're there for. Thank you very much. Slán an is.